Mr. Stanley, Surrey is that slightly mysterious figure who, by his own admission, was the major architect of the Tax Reform Act of 1969, considered a step in the right direction by some critics of tax policy, considered by others one of the most maladroit pieces of tax legislation in American history. Mr. Surrey, who is a professor of law at Harvard, is the founder of the concept of tax expenditures. By this, he means that the amount of money lost to the government by its failure to tax somebody or something at the usual rate should not be thought of so much as an effort to make social policy as a straight-out subsidy. So why not eliminate the loophole and, where desirable, subsidize directly? I'll tell you why not in just a minute. Mr. Surrey is a graduate of City College of New York and of the Columbia Law School. After being admitted to the bar, he taught for a while and then went down to Washington to work with the New Deal in the National Recovery Administration and the NLRB. He went into the Navy and then resumed academic work at the University of Columbia. During the 60s, he served as Assistant Secretary for Tax Policy for the Treasury Department, whence he came to judge the tax policies of the living and the dead. Returning to Harvard, he has written many articles and now his new book, Pathways to Tax Reform. I should like to begin by asking Mr. Surrey why he believes in continuing the investment tax credit.
Well, you say, why do I believe in continuing the investment tax credit? I don't think I would come down as hard as you do in saying continuing the investment tax credit. I look on the investment tax credit, which, as I guess most people in the tax field know, is a credit against tax for 7% of the cost of machinery and equipment that a businessman buys. It is a straight subsidy to induce business to buy machinery and equipment. Its use, therefore, is to encourage the economy. I would not keep the investment credit on year in, year out. I would use the investment credit when economic circumstances required that there be a stimulus to the economy. But I look upon it as merely a method of stimulating the economy, and I can have some qualms about it as to whether I should use the tax system for that purpose, but it is one of the things I would probably use the tax system for.
But isn't it your general proposition that to encourage a particular form of activity, economic or social, by the device of tax incentives is to be avoided? And it interests me that you should make an exception here. I'm, of course, aware of your reasoning, but I'd like to hear you state it.
Well, I don't think one can be a purist and an absolute about these things. We now use the tax system for about $65 billion of subsidies. Mm-hmm. Now, in a general way of speaking, I would go through those $65 billion of subsidies and decide in the first place, does the government want to continue these subsidies? If the answer is no, that the government does not want to assist the people or the things assisted by some aspects of the $65 billion, then we don't have any question. If, however, public policy, the government decides we do want to assist those people who are presently assisted by these tax subsidies, then our next question is
how to do it.
How to do it, whether we should use the tax system or whether we should use direct expenditures.
Yeah.
And my general conclusion is that with respect to most of the matters, I would not use the tax system. I would use direct expenditures. And the one I put at the borderline, for reasons I can explain later, is the investment tax credit.
Why don't you explain it now?
Well, the investment tax credit is an aspect of high visibility.
Mm-hmm.
You can see it. It stands out. Everybody knows it has nothing to do with the tax system. People know what its objective is. So consequently, it's there, you can look at it. In fact, it has been suspended twice already in our history. So we realize it's not an indigenous part of the tax system. We can understand we're dealing with assistance to businessmen. Now the question comes down in the large, is it relatively simpler as an administrative matter on the whole to send out checks from the Department of Commerce, which we could do for 7% of the cost of the machinery, or use a credit.
Subtract it.
Or subtract it from a person's tax. Mm-hmm. There are some disadvantages in using the tax system, but I think those are at the periphery and become quite technical.
Mm-hmm.
But this is a borderline case. And for example, if one were to say, let's scrap the investment credit and instead send checks to every businessman equal to 7%, because mm-hmm. That would be all right, too. That would be pretty close to the effect of what we're doing today.
Well, it would offend a little bit your idea of what you call tax logic, wouldn't it?
Not particularly, because this is a flat amount. It is a credit against tax. It's mm-hmm. not like a deduction, which mm-hmm. gives the greatest benefit to the person with the highest tax rate. Mm-hmm. It is a flat amount. Now, there are some difficulties with it. Being a credit against tax, it doesn't give any help to the businessman who happens to be losing that year, and therefore not having any tax to pay, the credit is not of any utility to him in that year, whereas a direct check from the Department of Commerce would. Mm-hmm. So it has some disadvantages, and I say it is just at the borderline of whether you use the tax system or whether you use a direct subsidy.
Mm-hmm.
But it wouldn't offend me to change to a direct subsidy, and if you want to keep me 100% logical, I will change to a direct subsidy on that.
Okay. Now, it seems to me that underlying your philosophy, which by the way I find rather attractive, because I am opposed to the same circumlocutions that I think you were opposed to. I know from seeing your book, but it seems to be plain from your philosophy that you more or less start off on the assumption that what you're dealing with is the government's money, whereas I start off on the assumption that what you're dealing with is the individual's money or the corporation's money, so that what you insist on calling tax a subsidy, tax expenditures, I would simply view as a form of remission. If you have, let's say, a flat tax of 25%, and somebody ends up paying, say, only 20% because he gives contributions to Harvard University, you consider this a subsidy to Harvard University, don't you?
Yes.
Whereas I tend to consider it as primarily leaving to the individual, or taking from the individual, less than you had decided to take from him. Now, your philosophy, it seems to me, rests completely on a total acceptance of the progressive rate, doesn't it?
Yeah. Well, it does, but not necessarily. In other words, if this discussion can be continued for the moment without regard, for example, to progressive rate, although it wouldn't be as dramatic a discussion. For example, if one were to say, let's have a flat rate of tax,
mm-hmm.
and then one were to go on and say, as we do today, we shall not include in the income subject to that flat rate interest on so-called state and local bonds.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that would become a preference to that particular individual. The question is, why is that individual being given a preference? Why is there a departure from the inclusion of all income in the base for whatever the tax rate may be?
Mm-hmm.
The progressive character of the rate makes it much more dramatic, because an exclusion from a 70% rate is far more important than exclusion from a 14% rate.
Well, only because you're charging 70% to begin with.
That's right. But I don't agree, for example, with the way you characterized my general position, in which you said, I believe the money belongs to the government, and you believe the money belongs to the individual.
Mm-hmm.
People often say that when they want to attack me. But I don't really think it's an accurate way of expressing the matter.
How would you put it?
Well, I would put it this way. We have decided to have an income tax in this country. Now, we can leave aside the decision why we decided to have an income tax, but we decided to have one.
Mm-hmm.
All right, then the question is, what does it mean to have an income tax? Well, first, I suppose it means that the base of the tax, the thing we're going to tax, is an individual's income.
Mm-hmm.
Now, having decided that, then any exclusion from our concept of income becomes a particular preference for that individual as compared with other individuals who are differently treated. So take the easiest illustration, interest on state and local bonds. The person who receives interest on state and local bonds simply has less of his income tax compared to the individual who invests in savings accounts or corporate bonds.
Well, it's a little bit more complicated because he's being paid pro tanto less in interest by the borrower.
So
therefore, there is, in effect, a hidden tax there. If he's getting only 5% tax-free, whereas he could be getting 9% somewhere else and paying taxes on it, he's about even.
No, he isn't about even. And that's why if a wealthy person wants to invest in securities, bonds, he does not invest in corporate bonds because he does far better. If he invests, let me put it this way, the general level at which a state and local bond sells compared to a corporate bond is about 75% less interest. At a 70% tax, however, complete freedom from tax on the state and local bond is worth far more than the net after tax on a corporate bond. So consequently, an individual comes out far better buying a tax-exempt bond, considering his net interest after tax, than he does buying a corporate bond.
Well, but if that, there are extrinsic considerations to the mathematical laying of it out. Otherwise, the market would bid up the price of tax-exempt bonds to the point of causing to vanish that disparity.
The difficulty is that there aren't enough really wealthy individuals to buy all the bonds.
Thanks to you.
What, beg pardon?
Thanks to you.
Well, the tax came before I came in this world. there aren't enough wealthy individuals to buy. To bid them up. Consequently, the rate has to be made more attractive to people in the lower brackets, for example, made attractive to banks, which are in the 50% bracket and are the largest buyers of state and local bonds, or attractive to individuals in the 40% bracket. When you do that, the windfall to the 70% bracket man becomes greatly accentuated.
Sure. Well, the fact that the government, the federal government, does not tax the bond rate of municipalities is intended to communicate something, right?
That's correct.
It's intended to say the city of New York, when it wants a new sewer, is going to be encouraged to borrow the money a lot cheaper than it would have to on the
That's
open
right.
competitive market. Now, you say this doesn't make much sense. It would make much more sense for the federal government to award to New York City $200 million or whatever to build the new sewer, that it is a more direct way of doing it, and that you are not, by doing it that way, conferring special benefits on a particular class of people.
Yes, the exemption of tax-exempt bonds is an obvious tax unfairness. And the question is, why has it been retained over these years? And the answer, I think, is that it does produce lower rates of interest for states and localities, and the Congress wants to give that assistance to states and localities. Mm-hmm. Consequently, that being so, we will never get rid of this exemption unless we substitute a direct system.
Yeah.
Now, why do I think a direct system would be better? Well, if you look at the numbers, it presently costs the federal government about roughly $3 billion in lost revenue. The interest savings to state and local governments are about a little over $2 billion. $1 billion disappeared somewhere. That $1 billion disappeared as a commission, really, to banks and individuals to buy these bonds. Now, if the federal government is willing to lose $3 billion, it might as well give it directly to state and local governments, and it doesn't need a middleman to act as the commission person. But let me finish. What is the present virtue of the system as seen by a governor, let's say?
A governor of a state?
Governor of a state. Mm-hmm. The virtue is that he has a blank check on the Treasury Department and nobody questions why he's issuing a bond or why the mayor's issuing a bond. Because tax exemption goes to any bond without any questions asked. Now, my guess is you would have to duplicate that condition in any direct assistance. And therefore, my proposal would be that state and local governments issue taxable bonds and that the Treasury, without asking questions, just as it doesn't ask questions today when it gives tax exemption, simply send a check to that governor or that mayor for a proportion of the interest on the bond, roughly 40%.
Mm-hmm.
In that sense, the federal government would lose pretty much what it's losing today, but everything would go directly to that mayor or that governor or that city or that state, and there would be no escape from tax by individuals. No commission paid, just to the middleman.
Well, but would you require that these bonds first of all find purchases on the commercial market before the government conferred a subsidy?
Yes, the bond would be issued. Once the bond would be issued, it would be like any corporate bond. And a lot of people would buy these bonds who can't buy them today. Pension trusts and universities who are presently tax-exempt don't invest in state and local bonds. There would be a wider market for state and local bonds, because then the bond would carry an interest rate comparable to a corporate bond.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I see absolutely no objection to it at all. My principal quarrel with your thesis is that on the one hand, you are a moralist, a tax moralist, and on the other hand, you feign that scientific detachment by the very simple expedient of saying the fact of the matter is that the American people voted a progressive rate, and they are being cheated of the impact of that progressive rate as a result of all these various exclusions. I think for rhetorical purposes, you are very clever in talking about the millionaires' advantages, whereas in fact, of course, the overwhelming practical advantages, not to millionaires, but to people who have mortgages on their homes and so on and so forth.
I don't want to let that one go by. Yeah. I mean, that was that was put out very fast, and I do think, in all respects, the data is the other way around. In other words, if you look at all these tax subsidies and add them up, the greatest advantage goes to the upper bracket people in this country. Because, for two reasons. One, in many respects, the thing subsidized is possessed only by upper bracket people. In other words, if you subsidize capital gains on securities, most of the corporate wealth in this country is held by about 5% of the people in the United States. Tax-exempt bonds, most of them are held by upper bracket people. Now, it is true that all individuals who pay a tax get some assistance when they buy their homes through the deduction of interest on mortgages and deduction of property taxes. But if one stops to think for a minute, what the federal government is really saying is, if a person has $100 of mortgage interest on his home, it's really saying to a man in the 70% bracket, we'll pay 70% of that mortgage interest. It's saying to a man in the 14% bracket, we'll pay 14%. Now, that's where the progressive rate comes in.
Your reasoning is absolutely circular, because you're saying that a man who's paying in the 70% bracket is being saved $70. But the answer is that he is the premier victim of a rate that is progressive in its architecture. Now, I don't consider myself a philanthropist. If I turn around to somebody from whom I was about to take, let's say, 99 out of $100 that he made, and say, I'm going to let you keep a 90 of it today, I simply consider that I'm heading in the direction of justice rather than of injustice. You use the word unfairness here. To the extent that you are able to isolate the advantages, for instance, of philanthropy to a man in the higher tax rate over a man, but I don't think it's an advantage when you need to start with the initial disadvantage.
Right. Well, perhaps let me. I think I can find a place where you and I would agree. Let's take corporations for a moment. Now, corporations pay largely a flat rate of tax, 48%.
Yeah.
Now, that's a flat rate, and it's not progressive.
It comes out at 36% effective.
Well, all right. But why does it come out to 36%?
Well, for instance, the first 25,000 are not taxed at the high rate.
All right, but let's.
You meddled with that, by the way, in your last 69 thing.
But let's stay on the 48% rate, which applies to the big corporations in the United States. Now, not every corporation pays 48%. Mm-hmm. So we're not dealing with a progressive rate anymore. Now, some businesses, some industries pay at lower rates than other industries because they have certain tax subsidies. Oil, for example, is one. Banks are another. Now, we haven't even brought the progressive rate into the picture, and yet my guess is that you would probably not agree with these differentials among industries.
No, I don't think it should be any tax at all. I think the corporation tax is boob bait. Yeah. It's the kind of thing that suggests to people that Nelson Rockefeller's paying for our free whatevers, whereas in fact they're paying for it. Because in a competitive situation, most of the corporation tax is actually paid by the consumer. Even if you accept the 50-50 business about the incidence of corporation tax, you would get a temporary windfall for the stockholder, mm-hmm. After which there would be an absorption of the almost a total saving to the individual consumer by the remission yeah. of all corporation
but,
tax.
But if without agreeing with you necessarily, mm-hmm. supposing the Congress of the United States disagrees with you mm-hmm. and says we are going to keep the corporate tax and we're going to keep it at 48%. Now, I presume you would argue, well, if you're going to keep it, then all corporations ought to pay it.
Yes, but we're here to talk about reform, right?
Yes.
And we're here to talk about in what direction should our tax philosophy move. I believe that it should move towards genuine equality. You believe that you ought to try to rectify some of those mitigations that have worked into a tax code which was so punitive in its architecture as to simply be unenforceable.
Well, you're coming down very hard on the fact you don't like the progressive rate structure.
Yeah.
I am saying that that is one aspect of the debate. The other aspect of the debate is, no matter what rate structure we have,
yeah.
we should make the base of that rate, the base to which the rates are applied, fair. In other words,
but how do you define fairness?
Well, now that gets me back to the concept of an income tax. Mm-hmm. If we choose a tax on income, most economists who deal with the field and most people have an understanding of what a person's income is. They know pretty well what net income is. And I say if you're going to choose that as the base, then you should stick to that. And you should not ask the tax to do other extraneous things by simply subtracting from that base.
Yes.
So I didn't think there was a difference between this basically.
I don't believe you should write social policy mm-hmm. Through taxes. But I do believe that necessarily you're going to, as long as you have a steeply progressive rate. Let's try to deal with very concrete symbols. Harvard University, mm-hmm. where you teach. Now, Harvard University is unquestionably, in some senses, the beneficiary of the deduction permitted to anybody who gives money to an educational institution, right? Let's say that comes to $20 million a year. Do I understand you to propose that Harvard University should receive $28 million a year from the federal government?
Now, of course, you're entering into a topic where it's very difficult. You understand, I have to wear two hats at the same time. Mm-hmm. I teach at Harvard, and it gives me an opportunity to inflict my views on younger people, and therefore I want Harvard to continue. And I suppose the charitable deduction is of utility to Harvard. On the other hand, I have to look at the thing as a tax person.
Yeah.
So let's try analyze this. What does the charitable deduction mean? Well, roughly, the government loses in revenue, if you let me use that term,
sure.
about $3.5 billion through the charitable deduction. My guess is that that $3.5 billion is simply transferred by donors to the objects of their bounty.
Mm-hmm.
Probably it does not induce any more extra giving from what the people have studied this show at best. In other words, when people give money, if you took away the charitable deduction, my guess is it would drop, the total amount of giving would drop by just the amount of what the government loses today. So that these donors are really transfer agents of government's checks. Now, you can say that's good because it gives us a pluralistic society. In other words, instead of Congress voting this money, citizens are voting $3.5 billion.
Yeah.
And you can say there are some virtues to that. Although it is interesting that the bulk of the charitable contribution deduction goes to people above $25,000, $30,000 in this country, a distinct minority of the people in this country. In other words, about...
Well, they have a residue, presumably.
No, I mean, but about one-fifth of the people are spending a good deal of the charitable deduction. Now, I would say I would not take away the charitable deduction unless we found a system that would say that same $3.5 billion went to charitable purposes. And therefore, I have to look for another device, and if I can't find one, I have to stay with the charitable deduction.
So you would be intellectually receptive to any proposal that discovered how to allocate, in effect, $20 million a year to Harvard.
Without using
this particular medium.
Yes, no, without using the tax system.
But are you going to reason a posteriori from Harvard to a system that yields the $20 million, or a priori from what is the kind of system that you like, leaving the question open whether Harvard would emerge as a beneficiary?
Well, that's one of the great difficulties. For example, some people have suggested that instead of a system that runs, a charitable deduction that runs through the tax system, we use a direct matching system. The government says, for example, if you send $100 to X donee, we, the United States government, will match that gift on a certain proportion. Now, that would mean that everybody's gifts would be matched, even the people who are not taxpayers today. And you can work out the terms of the matching. I think one problem with that, if I were in an educational university, is that probably educational universities would not come out with the same benefits as they have today, because they are the beneficiaries of, I think, most of the gifts of the well-to-do, and unless the matching structure were so structured, they would not receive as much money, and that would be one of the problems of that
drawback
system.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, why wouldn't you be attracted to a low uniform rate that whose purpose would be precisely to avoid implication in all these value judgments, which I think, coming around the other way, you quite properly resent. In the last analysis, wouldn't you agree that a democratic society is one in which the distance is as close as possible between the individual and that which that individual seeks to advance, whether it's a school or a church or whatever, and that if you get the government out of the picture, you're going to have a much more faithful image of a society that the people want, rather than a constant sort of a co-option of other people's dollars for private purposes?
Well, my general belief is that if we left charitable institutions to sink or swim on philanthropy, private philanthropy, they'd sink. So that my own feeling is, really, I don't think there would be enough money. If you just want me to finish, my own belief is that the real problem of those who are interested in philanthropy is to, over the next decade, work out formulae for government assistance that provides, nevertheless, sufficient private controls. And I think we're gradually coming to that with respect to the grants to the arts. We are coming to that with respect to federal aid to colleges, where we're trying to find formulae that, as far as possible, remove some of the details from political life. Now, that's just a viewpoint that I don't think the private system can depend upon private philanthropy alone. That's what I'm saying.
Well, but isn't this...
We're getting on to another subject.
I know, but isn't this the great psychic victory of the socialization of the charitable impulse? In the first place, I find a basic contradiction in the statement that says our society would not support philanthropy sufficiently if that society had to spend its money directly. But the same society will support philanthropy sufficiently through the medium of Congress. Since you're engaging in auto-taxation, why does John Jones, on the one hand, pay to say to the government, you may take $100 a year from me for the purpose of general educational expenditures, but I would not volunteer that $100?
Private philanthropy for years supported the poor. We now know it's a concern of government.
I know, but I'm asking you, since you're not afraid of radical thought, to reflect on this evolution and to ask yourself whether this isn't one of the paradoxes of democracy.
Well, I'm not sure it's a paradox of democracy. I think it's a problem in large part of numbers. The problems are very vast today.
Yeah, but the people are much more affluent today than they were during the early part of the century, when they supported educational institutions and churches and parochial schools and hospitals and so on and so forth.
But these are simply becoming more costly than I think private initiative is going to support it.
No, I think what's happened really is that people are trained to assume that there is a source of money in Washington, D.C. that needs only to be turned on in order to cause hospitals to materialize. But this is in part because there was such a vested interest in economic ignorance, isn't it?
Well, this is something that I don't think we can resolve here. I think the causes are different than the ones you indicate. And I was just saying that in the area which we got into on the charitable deduction, to get it back to the tax system, we're talking about a rather narrow point, and that is the utility of using the tax system to support philanthropy. Now, that the charitable deduction just happens to be one of the many of these various tax expenditures, both for corporations and for individuals. And I don't, and to my mind, I had singled out as three of the most difficult ones to deal with in the sense of changing them from tax subsidies to direct subsidies. One was state and local bonds, mm-hmm. where I had to devise a mechanism that would not have government control over the purposes for which the bonds are issued. Another is the charitable deduction, where I equally do not want government control. And a third, I think, is in the housing area.
And you propose what in the housing area?
Well, the housing area is divided now between owner-occupied homes, which is our biggest federal housing program. It doesn't show up in the budget of the United States because the budget never talks about what we're talking about. But there's clearly a subsidy to owner-occupied homes.
There you go, using the word subsidy again. By lowering the level of taxation, you call it a subsidy, by taking less.
Subsidizing. If I say to a person that rents a house, you get no deductions, and I say to a person that buys a house, we are going to add to the computation of your income an element of consumption, mm-hmm. which is not an element of determining your net income, as most economists would define it, we are reducing his tax because we want to subsidize his consumption of home ownership.
See, but subsidize is an unfortunate word. It's a value impregnated word.
No.
Suppose I have a slave, go back 100 years. Mm-hmm. Suppose I have a slave and I turn to my slave and I say, Rastus, you can take a day off every week. Mm-hmm. Now, am I subsidizing his freedom?
Well, the point is that you don't want to start from my fundamental premise. And I think you either have to accept or reject it.
No, well, yeah, as a reviewer of your book, the New York Times said, you really aren't a scientist. I say this with due respect.
Yeah,
I prefer non-scientists.
I'm a lawyer.
that's right. But you insist that your observations are scientific in nature, whereas, in fact, I think that they are. Based on a highly articulated set of personal value preferences.
No, I don't think so.
You don't think so?
No, I don't. In other words, and I have given a good deal of thought to that. And parenthetically, let's not say my judgments. This tax expenditure budget, which singles out those items which are treated as subsidies, is also published by the tax committees of the Congress of the United States.
Yeah, but that was your innovation, wasn't it?
But I don't control these gentlemen, and this was published long after I left the government.
No. You furnished a very useful vocabulary,
and they agreed with it.
Sure. If somebody says, "Look, let's cause any contributions to zoos to be deductible,"
no.
Somebody's entitled to say, "Well, how much is that going to mean that we have less money of?"
No.
And after the sociologists examine the pattern of giving to zoos, you can say it's going to cost $120 million a year. But it's whether that's a subsidy
okay.
or a remission that I think is important.
Let me indicate to you how I get there. Let's suppose that a country who never had an income tax wants to have an income
yep.
tax. And so the Secretary of the Treasury, the finance minister in that country says, I want an income tax.
Devise me one.
Now, let's assume they go about it in a rational way. Presumably, they would call in economists and lawyers who are used to working with what is income, what is an income tax. My guess is if you locked up most economists in a room, they would give you a standard definition of what is income, and it is the accretion to a person's wealth between two periods of time, and that is his income. Now,
yeah.
let me just...
What would be the term for that in the tax schedule? Gross personal income?
It would be adjusted gross income, but they would say less the expenses of earning that
right.
income because the tax is not on gross income, it's on net income,
right.
and if you pay wages or buy goods, right? And they would say, that's the definition of income. Yeah. Then they call in some accountants and the like, and they would say, give us some accounting principles. And then they go back to the minister, and they would say, now here's the net income tax. And he would say, well, you haven't answered all my questions.
Mm-hmm.
You have no rates in here. They would say to him, that's not a scientific question. That's your business.
Right.
You have no exemptions in here. Personal exemptions. Mm-hmm. They would say to him, that's your business. That's a value judgment
right. That
we can't make. Then he would say, well, I like this very much, but I would like to help people to own homes.
Encourage
people to own homes. Yeah. And I want you to create a special deduction for home ownership.
Mm-hmm.
And they would say, Mr. Minister, you know, that's departing from our definition of net income because that's a consumption item and that's not an expense of earning income. Mm-hmm. He would say, I understand that.
We'll waive that.
He says, I understand that, but I want this policy engrafted onto your income tax. Well, they would say, Mr. Minister, you're Mr. Minister or Mr. Secretary, and we will give a deduction for the cost of home ownership. Now, the minister could equally have said, okay, if you fellows are going to stick to your definition of income, we'll do this. I instead will go over to the Minister of Housing and ask him if he will send some checks to homeowners.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I don't need you fellows in the income tax. I can go over to the Minister of Housing. Now, the Minister of Housing may say, yes, I'll do it. Or he may say, oh, well, come on now. I don't want that in my budget. Why don't you tuck it in as a little deduction in the income tax and people won't see it and there won't be much argument about it. Now, that's my approach to these matters.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, I have to have a standard of definition that tells me what is appropriate to an income tax. I think I have one, which is by using primarily what economists, accountants, and lawyers are used to. And the fact that it was not very hard to get agreement within the government and the staffs of Congress on what are these tax subsidies would indicate that my standard of reference is a pretty useful one. That's all I'm saying. Mm-hmm. They're borderline questions and so on. But
no, I find that absolutely persuasive. I think that is a thoroughly defensive methodology on the basis of which one understands
mm-hmm.
What is the economic meaning
mm-hmm.
Of any of these particular laws. But it's when you start using words like unfair and so on that you have, in my judgment, allowed your redistributionist zeal to take over your calm, scientific capacity to objectify.
Let me stay calm and scientific, but answer that.
Mm-hmm.
Supposing we do come to a decision that we want to subsidize, we want to give assistance to, and I don't object to giving government assistance. I don't know whether we differ on that, but I don't. We want to give government assistance to, let us say, housing.
Mm-hmm. Now, towards the acquisition of houses?
Toward the acquisition of houses.
Yeah.
And the question then is, should we use the tax system or should we use a direct system?
Mm-hmm.
And what are the criteria that determine choice?
Yeah, and what tends to happen
if you do one or the other? That's right. Now, given our present tax system, for the moment, even though you may disagree with it, it is a progressive system.
Yeah.
Consequently, any deduction mm-hmm. for this consumption item
helps more people whom a deduction is more meaningful.
So it is an upside-down subsidy. Now, we would never come in with an upside-down subsidy. The Minister of Housing would never come in with an upside-down direct subsidy. He would never come in and say, gentlemen, I have a very good housing plan. It happens to subsidize 70% of the cost of home ownership for the wealthy, 14% for people in low brackets, and those who are too poor to pay an income tax, we don't give any money to. He wouldn't be Minister of Housing or Secretary of HUD for very long. So he wouldn't come in with that.
No, but suppose he went on to say, this is because you have begun with a progressive rate.
But that's given.
Right.
That's given because our choice today is which of these two systems to use. Now, therefore, I would say, when you use the tax system, you're inevitably involved in these upside-down subsidies.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm really testing one method of assistance against the other.
Yeah.
I have some other objections, and that is it divides expertise in our government. Mm-hmm. In other words,
the wrong congressional committee.
The wrong congressional committee. You suddenly take all of the housing problems. We have a committee for that, and you throw them into the Ways and Means Committee. Yeah. And to me, that's not rational government.
Yeah, that's a very shrewd point. It's a very shrewd point. But it is also true that the government gets so scrambled up in its effort that it then proceeds to try to compensate for the very lowest income bracket by subsidies of a different order. For instance, as you know, the highest tax on the lowest income people in the United States is the property tax, 21%. And under the circumstances, since you can't live on $2,000 a year, let alone if you're paying half of it in tax of one form or another to the state and the federal government, the governments have to proceed to subsidize, whether it's through guaranteed low income, low interest rates, or direct subsidies of a different kind. Under your system, that too would flush out, wouldn't it?
Well, you're asking me, I think, how I would run a property tax, perhaps. And I don't happen to be a leading property tax expert, federal government having no property tax. I would suppose, parenthetically, that...
But it is a tax subsidy, by your vocabulary.
If I were to say I will not apply the property tax to people of low incomes, for example, which I think is what you were saying, yes, then I am simply, in a sense, relieving them of that. Now, you can argue it's a subsidy with respect to the property tax. That's my starting point. Just, for example, as if I had a sales tax and I said, I don't want the sales tax to apply to people with the lowest incomes. Yeah. I have to work out some mechanical exemption.
Yeah.
Just as I say in the income tax, remember in our illustration of we were making up a tax system, where should the tax start?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's a social question. You have to have an answer for it. It can start at zero income, or it can start somewhere above zero income. I have to have a policy outside of the, partly outside of the tax system that decides that question for me.
Yeah, yeah. If our Bill of Rights had, for instance, said that there would be no inequality except under due process of law, on the basis of which if somebody was charged a greater percentage of his income than somebody else,
mm-hmm.
then you would accept that as the given and proceed to try to make a tolerable society to the extent the government is involved in efforts to make tolerable society.
It might be hard. It might be hard to do that because that gets us back to our questions of what do we think about progressive versus non-progressive taxation, or
sure.
how do we think the burden should be distributed, and,
sure.
and that's a different matter. Than what I'm talking about.
Mr. Kuttner is with the Village Voice here in Washington. Mr. Kuttner? Do you have a question?
I do. You said, I believe, Professor, that we lose something like, we don't lose, we expend something like $65 billion a year in tax expenditures. How much of that is leakage? How much of it goes to the presumed socially useful purpose? And how much of it goes to, in effect, subsidize the income of the wealthy by lowering their tax bill?
That's rather a hard question to answer because in many of these cases, we've never put that question before. In tax-exempt bonds, for example, I answered it that there's a 30% wastage. I think in the subsidies that we give to housing, low-income housing, where we have the device of tax shelters, in other words, we give very large depreciation deductions to people to invest in low-income housing, my guess is there's about a 40% wastage there. In drilling of oil, when we subsidize tax shelters for oil, my guess is there's about a 30% wastage there. Charitable deduction, I think maybe there's not much wastage there. These differ depending on particular matters, and I don't think there's been enough attention given to this concept of wastage because we haven't thought in those terms mm-hmm. before.
And of course, you don't have the figure of hand, do you, of the wastage involved in the misallocation of capital as a result of an effort to avoid high taxation?
No, I don't. In other words,
think it would certainly exceed the wastage you're trying to...
Yeah, that isolate. Would be some part of our maintaining rates. And parenthetically, when I was in the Treasury, I did recommend a top rate of it may be still high for you, a top rate of 50% if it applied to all income,
mm-hmm.
all economic income.
You spoke of three examples, housing, charitable deductions, and state and local bonds. Could you come up with a reasonably efficient alternative mechanism to subsidize socially desirable objectives other than the tax system in every one of the major areas where the tax system is now used?
Well, I could. In many of them, I wouldn't do it, for example. I would not subsidize American corporations to invest abroad. So there's a whole range of subsidies, which I would say, if you were going to test these tax subsidies by the question, would you give direct assistance for this objective, my guess is the Congress of the United States would say, no, we do not want to give direct assistance. If they were to answer the question that way, I drop it and I don't have to devise an alternative. For most of them, the others, I think it would be relatively simple to devise a direct program, because in many of these fields, relief for the aged, we do have direct programs. We simply divided it between the tax system and elsewhere.
But
it's only in a few where there are criteria or effects, let us say, built into the use of the tax system that if we have to duplicate, then I have to think a lot more.
But are there any major ones where it would be the least awkward way to do it, to keep it in the tax system?
My guess is the one that
you gave an example.
Mr. Buckley started out with, the investment credit. I don't think it makes too much difference where you leave it. The charitable contribution one is a bit difficult if you want to end up where you are today. Those are, I think, the only mm-hmm. ones.
Mr. Onek, formerly of the staff of Senator Kennedy.
On the same point, couldn't we even retain many of the subsidies but fine-tune them to a greater degree? For example, we could have the home ownership subsidy but put a limit on the size of a mortgage that a person could deduct or on the income level of people who'd be permitted to deduct. So you'd have the same type of subsidy, but certain people, because of their massive income or the massive house that they're buying, would be ruled out. And that at least would save some money to the Treasury and yet leave the basic congressional goal, which is, I assume, to help middle income and lower income people intact.
That's correct. Although, and one has to remember that every time you say you're going to use the tax system to help somebody, you generally never help the person who is not, doesn't have the money to pay a tax. In other words, the family of four, say below around $4,000 to $5,000, as their exemption goes up, because a deduction doesn't help them if they don't pay a tax. So you always have to keep that in mind, that you are disenfranchising some people from assistance when you use the tax system. But in general, I could say, if you wanted to continue to use the tax system, yes, you could put limits on the amount of the deductions, and that would take off a good deal of the upside-down effect.
I'd like
it would depend, surely, because if the money thus freed that wouldn't qualify for the benefits you talk about sought out other enterprises mm-hmm. and received relief there, you would have no net effect on the taxation of that person. But you would have his money pursuing will-o-wisps.
Well, you say if you close this route, he runs to this route.
Sure.
Yes, but I believe if you close this route, mm-hmm. you'll start paying more attention as to that route mm-hmm. and so on, and that you can keep chipping away at these one by one, and that's the path of tax reform.
There's a point that I think we've been talking around, but we haven't been willing to focus on, and that is the progressive income tax. And obviously, Mr. Buckley doesn't like it, and the University of Chicago economists don't like it. But I think most of the American people think that it is fair, a value-laden word, but that's what politics is all about. And isn't the problem, then, that all of these subsidies are, in fact, a way of deceiving the American people? They think they are in a tax system which is progressive, but in ways that they can't really understand unless they're lawyers or economists, they're being deceived because it isn't a progressive system. Because, in fact, the rate is much flatter than they think. And isn't that one of the issues that we should confront, regardless of how you come out, even if you're for a flat system? I take it you should be for an honest system in which the American people know what they're getting and they're not sold a bill of goods. And if they think they're getting a progressive system, then they should have such a system. And if it doesn't work out, then they can change it openly, not the kind of hidden changes that go about because of these tax subsidies.
Well, I think you're 100% right, that people ought to understand what it is that they're doing. 10 years ago, somebody conducted a poll asking what they thought the highest rate ought to be. The overwhelming majority said 25%. Then they said, how high do you think it fact is? And the answer was 30%. This was during a period when, in fact, during the Korean War, counting the surtax, it was up around 77%. Now, if we accept the notion that people ought to understand what it is that's going on, it includes penetrating all kinds of economic myths, including this one. The effective rate of taxation at the highest level is about 44%, though ostensibly it is higher than that. And I think that Mr. Surrey and I would agree that this ought to be made manifest, shouldn't it?
Well, I'm in favor of openness, and yeah. It should be. And that, in a sense, is what shakes people up when you get a statement that 100 people with incomes of over $200,000 didn't pay any tax in the United States.
Excuse me?
When 100 people with incomes of over $200,000 didn't pay any tax in the United States, any income tax in the United States.
In the United States?
Yes. Now.
Yeah, but they paid tax.
I mean, income paid, tax.
Sure. They may have paid a huge tax in England.
No, no. No.
In Venezuela.
No. Most of these people who are in that are not people of foreign income. That would be true of corporations.
Yeah.
And
well, let's put it in context. Account. We're talking about 15,000 people, 15,000 Americans who made more than 200,000, of whom 106, mm-hmm. Didn't pay any federal income tax. Are you here to say that they didn't pay any taxes anywhere? There were no tax credits involved?
And most of them are not due to foreign tax credits.
Most of them, some yes.
A few maybe, but very few.
And there were 15,000 people who reported incomes of more than $15,000. Yeah. And as I understand it...
More than $200,000.
$200,000. But as I understand it, there are certain categories of income that you don't even have to report.
Yes, so you don't know where... Well, tax-exempt bonds are one,
yeah.
for example. But no, I don't think the foreign tax credit is that important for individuals. It does. It is of importance, and in fairness to companies, when you're dealing with what taxes they pay, because most of the foreign tax credits go to our corporations, very few to our individuals.
Yeah.
But these people are just the top of the iceberg, I think, in this area, and that does disturb the American people, and properly so. And I think that, in a sense, is why people have an interest in tax reform in this country. I think as a nation, we do pay our taxes, and most people generally comply on the whole. They don't have many alternatives. Their taxes are withheld from them, and so on. But they are aggrieved, and they should be, when they find the very wealthy not supporting the federal government.
They're also very, very aggrieved, and as a matter of fact, they seem to be much more excited about welfare chiselers. The answer is, of course, that there are chiselers at every level of society, middle income, upper income. In fact, some people say that the true villains in American society are the middle class. The middle class are described as people who earn between $7,000 and $15,000 a year, because we all know that, in fact, the rate of taxation does increase effectively when you get up above $30,000, but it does not increase significantly between, say, $5,000 and $15,000. So who are the villains? The welfare chiselers, the 105 people out of the 15,000 very rich, the middle class that coordinates tax policies for its own benefit, depends on what polemical literature you pick up. Which is one of the reasons why I agree with the economist at the University of Chicago that we should have a proportional taxation. Yeah. Among other things, to avoid invidious conversations of this nature.
Well, I think, as this gentleman said, you're turning the clock back, and you're reaching a position which is not acceptable in our society, and therefore I don't really think is helpful in solving the tax problems we do have.
Yeah, well, of course, and the manumission of the slaves wasn't acceptable 100 years ago.
Uh-huh.
This simply has to do with the recovery of a philosophical insight, one of which, it strikes me as basic, is that people ought not to be singled out as a class to be penalized as a result of the fact that they want to work harder or that their work is put a higher premium on by society.
Or inherited more.
Well, sure, a lot of people do work hard, not for themselves precisely. Under your tax code, they would almost feel obliged to squander their wealth before they died.
I don't think...
They sometimes work for other people.
You're making assumptions which I just don't think are borne out, that high tax rates, 50% top rate on all economic income, would discourage incentive. I don't think so.
Oh, well, as a matter of fact, I don't think 50% of the censorship of the press would hurt us much. But I'm against it. It's a matter of principle.
Mm-hmm. Well, But I think the real issue is, you can have your long-range point of view, and I can't quarrel with it, because it's your point of view. I can't deny it to you, and I can quarrel with it, but it isn't going to advance us particularly. But I think, really, in looking at the situation over the next decade, the real question is going to be, given the progressive tax structure in the United States, how are we really going to make it fair, and how are we going to reform it and make it fair so that within that idea which we have, the American people assume it is fair. And I think we can do it, but it takes a lot of work.
Mr. Kudner, we have another minute or two.
I wonder how much effective tax a person who earns $500,000 as the president of a corporation, or $250,000 as the president of the United States, with a good accountant, a clever accountant, what's the highest effective tax that he need pay?
Well, the maximum tax on earned income is 50% in the United States. On earned income, you need not pay higher than 50%.
But as a practical matter, with a good accountant, what's the top?
I can't answer that question because it depends on how he takes his compensation, whether he takes it in the form of a stock option, whether he takes it in the form of straight salary, whether he takes it in the form of deferred compensation and the like.
But in any case, the figures are published. The effective rate is 44%.
Well, that's the effective rate on taxable income. But if you take the effective rate on economic income, which is including it generally it doesn't rise above about 30%.
Are you going to count marital felicity?
No, just income, economic income. It doesn't rise much above 30% in the United States for any bracket. Now, that may help to answer your question. All the top rates of tax are 65% or 70%, and 50% on earned income.
Would you just spend a second, which is all we have left, on defining that economic income?
Well, economic income, I think, is the way economists define it. It is the net accretion to a person's wealth between two periods of time. Mm-hmm. He starts out on January 1st with a certain amount of money. Yeah. He ends up on
Does that discount inflation for that year?
You can take inflation into account or not.
But did you in that 30%?
That does not take into account.
So if you have 7%, then that would be right away 37%.
Well, but
if you're talking about economic meanings, net economic meanings.
No, if you're talking about constant prices, but everybody's income is going to rise proportionately. You may rise in higher brackets, and you have that problem, but that's a separate problem, I think.
Thank you very much, Professor Surrey, the author of Pathways to Tax Reform. Thank you, Mr. Kudner, Mr. Arnick, ladies and gentlemen.
Next week on Firing Line, Politics and Black Progress with John Lewis and Julian Bond.
For a printed bound copy of this program, send 25 cents in coin to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. That's 25 cents to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. This program was made possible by a grant from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.